Today with us is Dr. Carl Stauffer, who is working as a senior expert for reconciliation at the U.S. Institute for Peace in Washington, D.C., where he is currently based. He has practiced trauma healing, nonviolence, restorative justice, and reconciliation for 3 decades and in 37 countries. Isn't that amazing? And for the past 10 years, he has served as the academic director for the Caux Scholars Program in Switzerland. Without further ado, I pass it on to Dr. Carl.
Thank you so much, Cinda, and I appreciate the introduction. And it's a real privilege to be here with you as a group and to have this moment to have some conversation. But even more, I look forward to engaging with you in the questions you might have along the way. Jonas invited me as a former co-scholar, and it was a real privilege to be able to accept and get engaged here again, even though it's online. I spent almost a decade traveling to Caux and for the Caux Scholars Program each summer in the month of July. And so it's good to have this reconnection with other folk connected across the world to this incredible movement, Initiatives of Change, and to this conference on creative leadership. I hope it's going well. I've been given the task of taking the theme of holding the troubles, which was really a fascinating theme for me to take on, because I have a passion about what it means to do this work for the long term. And I'm also passionate about it because I've seen many of my colleagues drop out of this work. Some have been casualties literally, and sometimes figuratively, literally have lost their life for this work, but figuratively, they've burned themselves out or have been unable to sustain this work for the long haul. And so I have a strong urge and a passion to talk on this issue of how do we hold all of the pain, all of the challenge, all of the weariness, sometimes the sense of hopelessness that we may feel as we continue in this work of peace building and attempting to transform the many conflicts that each of us face in different contexts. And I'm going to share a little bit of my journey today. I hope that it'll be both insightful as well as not entertaining, but enjoyable in the sense that I hope to use some humor, even though this is a deep and challenging subject. And so there'll be a little bit of both of those woven through the stories that I will tell today. So I'm going to go ahead and share my screen and move into our conversation together. I hope we can all see this. So I subtitled my talk today, When Trauma Revisits You Uninvited. This comes from my lived experience and work with trauma and peacebuilding and conflict resolution in South Africa for 16 years. One of my colleagues, a young activist, Sekwefatso, and I were facilitating a peacebuilding course 6 years after the end of the civil strife in South Africa. The ANC had been in power for 6 years. And so there was an all-inclusive majority government, and the country was slowly making its way back or hoping to make its way through a healing process. But Sekwefatso, my colleague, she had seen a lot of violence as an activist. She had been put in jail herself. And I'm sure I hadn't heard all the stories of what she had experienced and what she had carried. And we were in a workshop, and we attempted something that's not something that I would easily do or quickly do unless I felt like the group that I was training with was comfortable and ready and there was enough trust. And so we did what we call role reversal. We tried to get the group to play the role of the opposite, the party that you were in conflict with. So in this case, it was the ANC and the IFP, the opposition. And as we got into their roles, it became clear that the trauma was still too fresh. And people became very emotional playing these roles. And eventually we had to stop the whole exercise, the whole simulation, and debrief it because of the amount of trauma and emotion that it had called forth. And as I was talking with Caux Forum and debriefing this experience and trying to figure out what way to learn from it, she said to me, "Carl, there are many times when I will go for a drink with a comrade from the struggle, and we'll talk about the bad old days of apartheid." But she said, "Today, the trauma came back to me uninvited." And so I've thought of that many times since in working with trauma and traumatized communities and populations after war or during violence of various forms. One of the key things about trauma is we don't have control over it. It resides in us, and sometimes it comes out when we least expect it, especially if we haven't had a chance to process it and to heal from it, if we've suppressed it. And so I want you to hold that in mind as I tell some of my story. So my slides are not moving. Let me see if I can get this. There we go. So one thing I say before I get into some of the more substantive discussion around trauma is sometimes in our work, humor is the best medicine. Now, I want you to hear me carefully here. When I say humor, I don't mean inappropriate humor. I don't mean laughing at the expense of other people and their pain or their trouble. But if it wasn't for humor, which is one of the tools I believe we have, I would be deeply, deeply tired, deeply, deeply discouraged, possibly despondent or hopeless at this point, because humor is one of the ways in which we process and reflect and try to understand our world and our life. And so I often tell this story when I talk about trauma, just to lighten some of the process. It's not a light story, but it ended up being a funny story. So I was part of a scoping mission to Burundi in the Great Lakes region in Africa in 1999. It was the Quakers, and I was joining them, and we were scoping out what they could do around trauma healing and peace building after the fighting. And we landed in Bujumbura, the capital of Burundi, right after the rebels had been chased out of the city, and they were up in the mountains surrounding the city. So very close. It was a very tense day. We toured the city. We saw the destruction of the violence. We passed multiple checkpoints with big guns, military guards. And so the day was emotional and traumatic even on its own. And we got back to our residence, and I was with people I didn't know. I was meeting for the first time, and we had to share a room. It was a guest house. I had to share a room with the leader, and he was an older gentleman. I say that now and I smile because I'm older than he was now. Well, he was then, but back then he was an older gentleman leading our team. And we fell into our beds exhausted and went to sleep. I don't know if it was because of the trauma of the day or because I was taking anti-malarial medicine, which sometimes plays with your mind, but I had some vivid dreams that night. And in the process of those dreams, though, I began to awake at about 2 a.m. And you know how you awake slowly to a certain sound and to the rhythm of a certain sound. What I was awaking to, I thought in my head, sounded like gunfire. But in fact, it also involved the snoring of my colleague who was sharing the room with me. So I heard him snoring, his breathing in. You know, we know that sound. It's a familiar sound. You know, this was going on a regular interval. But when he would release the air, and this is where snoring gets very, very funny, he would release the air like this. So I'm hearing. Sounds like AK-47 shooting, you know, automatic rifle, whatever, you know, within a kilometer from where I was. And so I'm coming slowly too. And the first thought I have is the rebels are back in the city. And I'm like, I can't believe this is happening the first night that I'm here. And I'm thinking, do I need to get under the bed? What do I do? What's the emergency plan? We didn't talk about that. I wonder how close the fighting is. And all the while in the background, I'm hearing. What I eventually make sense of is that I'm puzzled. Why is the snoring in concert with the gunfire? The gunfire seems to stop every time my colleague snores. And suddenly I'm awake enough to realize that I have been listening to my colleague snore the whole time. The next morning we had some laughter and some stories to tell. And moments after that, I told him, his name was David. I said, David, you gave me a fright last night. And many other people back in South Africa asked me, are you afraid to go to, you know, weren't you afraid to go to Burundi? Was there any time that you felt like you feared for your life? And I said, yeah, there actually was. There was one moment at 2 a.m. in the morning after everything we had done on this scoping mission. And it was because of my colleagues snoring. So sometimes we just have to laugh about this work. Otherwise, we could never get through it. I was born and raised in Vietnam, the youngest child of church workers who were doing humanitarian and church work in Vietnam during the war. I was born in 1964. As you know, if you know the history, the Americans sent their first folk in military personnel in 59, and the war was in full swing by 1964. My parents stayed till 1975, when we left 3 weeks before Saigon was taken over by the North Vietnamese Communist Party. So I had experience as a child of war. Now, to my parents' credit, I never felt fear. I never felt, you know, panic. I never felt like, we're all gonna die. But the war came close to our home. Let me just jump ahead here. Here's a picture of our family driving on the transport that would have been very normal for the common transport of the day in Vietnam. And I'm the particularly unhappy looking young man in the front, standing in between my parents, my father's legs. These slides keep hopping without me touching them. And so here we were. Hold that picture for a little bit, because as I tell the story of when the war came the closest to us, this very scooter was the scooter that we ended up having to pile on, just as you see, to escape the fighting. So Vietnam is a beautiful country. It's a beautiful tropical country. If you have a chance to travel there, the food is exquisite, the hospitality, it's a beautiful place. The fruits are in abundance, and the rice paddies, the terraced rice paddies are stunning, and it's also a place that suffered war. And the war was, as all war, was horrific. There were so many casualties. It was a tragedy on so many fronts. It was not a war that could be won. And so many people have suffered as a result of this war. I'm wondering if my slides are on timed, some sort of timing, because I had used them before. But anyway, bear with me as I try to keep the slides from moving ahead of my story. So in 1968, the war came into Saigon, literally about a half mile from our home. We didn't know it at the time, but we did know it was close. There was a helicopter above our house raining gunfire down on a petrol station where there was the North Vietnamese had apparently taken over, we found out later. And the empty bullet shells, I remember the sound of the empty bullet shells falling on the corrugated tin roof. I remember crawling under the bed and my mom praying and we reading stories and singing, and as the house shook because of the mortar flying overhead, it really was quite traumatic. My father was listening to the radio, trying to figure out where the curfew was in the city and how close the fighting might be. A 13-year-old girl, neighbor girl, broke curfew. There was curfew over the whole city, and came over and told us as a family how to get out of the area through the back of our house, going through a back door and in through an informal settlement, which we had never used because the passageways, the alleyways were really narrow. And we all piled on the scooter and we left and went to another part of the city and stayed away for about 3 weeks before things settled down enough to come back to that home. And I tell you this story to say it was potentially very traumatic, but my parents seemed, as I said, to hold a kind of peace and calm. And so I never thought I was traumatized by this. But as time went on, what I didn't realize is that trauma can sit inside of us. And now we know from the study of trauma, trauma can sit inside of us for 10 years, a decade, 15 years even, sometimes before it might manifest. So there are multiple kinds of trauma. Let me just talk to a few of those on the left side of your screen. There is primary trauma, that's when trauma happens to you directly. There's secondary trauma, that is trauma that you witness or experience as someone close by, but it's not directly happening to you. There is multiple trauma. In many cases, trauma comes in multiple forms and people are experiencing trauma at different sectors in their life all at once. War is a good example of that. We may be fearing for our lives. We may be fleeing our homes. We may have to be as refugees. We may go through very, very difficult physical and emotional and challenges which are traumatizing. And so we have multiple traumas that are happening at once. And that's what we call multiple trauma. And then there's protracted trauma, and that is trauma that goes on and on, maybe for years, for months, for whatever period of time, depending on the intensity. It makes for a very complex process, what we call complex traumatic PTSD, which is post-traumatic stress disorder or syndrome. I was not experiencing primary trauma at that point, though I was in the sense that we had to escape the war, but I wasn't seeing the results of the war right in front of my eyes. But I was experiencing a secondary trauma as a child. And so I want you to hold that thought for a while and think about how we might hold trauma in our own lives sometimes, whether we know it or not. Now, how do we respond to trauma? We as human beings are complex. We're very, very unique. And so there's different ways in which we respond. But some of the major ways are what we know often. We talk about fight or flight. Some of us tend to stay and fight. Others run when we're under trauma or when we're faced with a situation of survival. But there are other ways in which we respond. It's not only fight or flight on two extremes. It's also what we call, what we've discovered in war, that soldiers use other tactics. One of them is posturing. What do we mean by that? It's like we posture to act big or to act brave or to act unafraid or to threaten another or to look like we're more confident than the other so that we hope that the violence will be taken away, will cease or without us having to engage. The other is submit. And sometimes, especially if we're children experiencing trauma, we don't have a choice. We don't have the choice to fight. We may not even have the choice to flight, to run. So sometimes we have to submit in order to survive. That does not mean we've accepted the trauma as something good or that we want it, but it's a matter. When I think about child soldiers, and I've worked with child soldiers in many parts of the world, they are forced to submit often by the threat of violence. And so many times they're accused of wanting to fight because they stay with a militia or a rebel movement for 7 years or something like that. But in fact, to escape would have meant certain death. And so they submit as a way of survival. I want to focus on secondary trauma. Secondary trauma is what I had experienced in Vietnam, but I didn't know it. Now, there are some symptoms, basic symptoms of trauma. There are some very complex ones. One of them is intrusion, and that's simply a big word for the idea of what we often call, in popular terms, flashbacks. So there'll be flashback memories of the trauma that will come to us sometimes when we haven't expected it or we're not asking for it. This is what my friend Caux Forum meant when she said, today my trauma came back to me uninvited. That's an intrusion, a flashback. Then there's hyperarousal. Many of us know that as an aggressive response to trauma. And we see this in school children, as well as in veterans of war who haven't experienced healing yet, et cetera. The hyperarousal is a sense that you are always under alert, that you are always under danger, and you are looking behind you. It's hard for you to sleep, and it's hard for you to sit still. And then the opposite of that is constriction, the idea that sometimes it depends on our personality. We might be aggressive about our response to trauma, or we might be depressive. We might turn it inward and suppress it. And this is also another form of trauma. Whichever of these kinds of responses to trauma you may have experienced, or anyone is experiencing, all of them are highly stressful and give us pause to think why it's so important to understand trauma and to understand healing. Now let's fast forward. I moved to South Africa in 1994, January 1994. I was 29 years old. So I had left Vietnam when I was 10 years old, almost 11 in 1975. So we're talking about a long period of time between my experience of war as a child and going to South Africa. We landed in Johannesburg. I knew I was going to be doing peace work. I had a role called, I think I was to be mediation trainer. I joined a South African NGO and a South African team that was working on peace building in that transition period. Now, for those of you who know about South Africa, between 1990, when Mandela was released, and 1994-95, there was a lot of violence because once he was released and the revolutionary liberation struggle movements were unbanned, they were banned and had been called illegal for 40 years under apartheid. When they were unbanned, there was a lot of vying for power and there was just a lot of social unrest and frustration that was released in South Africa as it stumbled towards becoming a new democracy. They had to negotiate a new government of national unity, a new constitution. There was the Truth and Reconciliation Commission. They had to figure out how to build relationship between the police and the community. It was a very, very harrowing time. And one of my onboarding processes when I got this job was my colleagues took me to a place where there was fighting had been quite extreme in one of the townships close to Johannesburg called Tokoza. And so we went to Tokoza and we were being led on a sort of tour of the area of where the fighting had happened by a young man, a young militant from the ANC side. And he was leading us through buildings that were burnt out. And we saw the bullet holes in the buildings. And along the main road, there was an armored personnel carrier moving up and down. It was hot. And I was on high alert, of course, because we were in a semi-low scale war zone. But as we were walking, I saw, and let me just jump ahead here. I forget my slides at times. Here's Johannesburg and well, it looks like a flourishing and amazing city, and it is. We were in a basic low scale war at that time. And there's still a great deal of political and social violence and unrest in South Africa. But as we were going through this area, I saw empty bullet shells laying on about three of them laying on the ground. And so I reached down to pick them up. And as I was holding them in my arm, I had a flashback. I had an intrusion. And it was back. It wasn't a specific memory. It was a sensual attack. In other words, I could smell, feel, and hear and sort of the emotion and the experience of war sort of flooded my inner being and my body. And I realized I tensed up and suddenly I was in a panic mode. I was in a mode in my head that said, you have to get out of here. You are in a war zone. You need to get out of here. Now, we weren't under immediate danger. And I wasn't traumatized enough that I started running or acting out in that way. But I was aware of what was happening enough in me that I had to talk it through to my colleagues, and they understood. And we moved the process along and left the area after some hours when I was able to, integrate what was happening and realize I wasn't under immediate danger, but that I would be okay, and that we weren't in a outright war zone, so to speak. Now that is secondary trauma coming back uninvited. That is a kind of revisiting that trauma can happen. And I was surprised. And what it did is it gave me pause. It gave me a red flag to say, Carl, you may have unhealed trauma in your life that you need to keep thinking about. But unfortunately, at that point, it wasn't severe enough that I didn't process it much further. Fast forward again, 2001. I've been invited to work with the refugee population from Sierra Leone in West Africa. Sierra Leone had gone through a brutal civil war, 12 years of war, and it was a highly, highly traumatizing brutal war. Sierra Leone is a beautiful coastal country, one of the poorest in Africa. And here we were working with the refugees who had fled the war and were together in a refugee camp in the neighboring country of Guinea-Conakry. And I spent 2 weeks there in the refugee camp, working with training and doing work on peace building and justice and reconciliation, trying to prepare the refugee facilitators who were going to go back and try to help with the process of people going back to their homes and relocating after the war. During those 2 weeks, I heard many, many very difficult stories. War is brutal enough as it is, but this war in Sierra Leone was particularly painful to hear about. A lot of pillaging, a lot of rape, a lot of amputation of people's arms and legs. There was reigns of terror by the militias and the rebel groups, and there were many in Sierra Leone. The army was implicated. It was a very devastating war for this small country of 4.1 million people. They used a lot of thousands of child soldiers between the ages of 7 and 15, many of them drugged when they did the horrific atrocities that they committed. And when we are the recipients, and you are the leaders of this generation, and some of you have already sat in this place and you've heard many stories. But I tell my students and those who are studying to be in this field of peace building, you have to become like a sponge. A sponge has to take in a lot of liquid. That's the point of it, to take in. We have to take in a lot of emotion, a lot of anger, a lot of grief in our work. But a sponge is only useful if it can be squeezed out. We can't use it anymore if it can't be squeezed out. And that's self-care. That's the mechanisms and the disciplines and the tools that we have to heal ourselves and to make sure that we are squeezed out, so to speak, of the trauma that we may be experiencing secondary or vicariously, as we call it. And so we have to handle the trauma stories we're hearing, even though they're not our own. What research shows is that we can take the trauma stories in, and if we take them in enough and internalize them without healing and without having a place to release them, we can start to experience the symptoms of trauma like it was direct trauma. We can start experiencing the symptoms of trauma of the people who told us the stories. So this is very serious. So we have to handle trauma stories with care. So I didn't realize how much of that trauma I was taking in. The same time I was in a refugee camp, which was very different. The housing was different and my food was different. And the refugees mostly ate rice which I was very familiar with from Vietnam. But what they topped the rice with mostly was potato leaves, green potato leaves. That was the greens. Every once in a while, there was a little fish or a hard-boiled egg in that platter. But I was eating mostly rice and potato leaves. And so I was losing weight and didn't quite have the nourishment that I was used to in those 2 weeks. And then my residents had a particular number of spiders who were coexisting with me. One of them I found in a pocket in my shirt when I took it off the hanger to put it on in the morning. And I never knew where they were at night. But what I do believe, I never had any way to confirm this. One morning I woke up and my eye was swollen red, closed. It was puffy. And I believed I was bitten by something. I didn't know what. And I was having an allergic reaction. I assumed it was a spider. Eventually the swelling went down and then it turned black and blue, like I had been in a bar fight or something. And so here I was and the skin was peeling off. So by the time I arrived in Johannesburg and my wife picked me up, I was feeling pretty undernourished. I'd lost weight. I had a black eye with skin peeling off, and I was exhausted, completely exhausted. I was a mess and I needed to rest. And I was never more happy to get back home to Johannesburg. I told my wife, I feel like getting down. You know how sometimes you see the people who get back home, they get down and they kiss the ground. You know, I was so happy to be home. I was so happy to be with my family. I was so happy to be in the house and have the amenities that I was used to. I was so happy to sleep in my own bed. And for 3 nights, I slept very well. The third night, I was again awakened about 2 a.m., this time by my own nightmare. And when I awoke, my heart was beating rapidly. I was sweating. And I was feeling very, very stressed. I can remember the nightmare as if it was last night. And again, it's almost funny to talk about the nightmare now, but it was very real at the time. And in my dream, I was in a war zone. The sky was gray. There was mortars flying over. And I was hiding in a burnt out vehicle under a burnt tree. And I was hiding in this vehicle waiting for a young soldier to bring me an AK-47. I was anxiously waiting. This is in my dream. Eventually, the young soldier came, young militia, a child soldier, really, he was. And he brought me my AK-47 and he showed me how to take it apart and put it back together and how to use it. I've never used an AK-47, but this is how it is in nightmares and dreams. And so I had this. I was armed and then he left. And then I jumped out from my hiding place and I began to run across an open space. And as I went, I fired. It literally felt like the Hollywood movies, you know, Rambo or something like that, you know, just sort of. And I woke up at that point. Now, as I said, when I woke up, I had all the symptomology of trauma, and I could tell that. And as I lay there on the bed, I began to ask myself, what's going on? What's happening to me? And I felt like the spirit spoke to me and said, you are becoming what you hate. In other words, I hate war and I hate violence and I hate the trauma and I hate the pain that it causes people. That's why I'm in this work. But suddenly in my subconscious, in my dream, I was coming to the place where I believed I needed to use violence in order to survive. And so what that said to me is I need to take care of myself. And so I canceled my next trips to Sierra Leone. I waited before I went back for a little longer. And I went into a process of taking care of myself. I knew that my wife couldn't be the one to handle all the stories. She had her own traumas. She was working with women and children, victims of rape and abuse, of course, we were supportive to each other. We both studied social work. We're in this field, but we couldn't be totally supportive because it was too much for some of us to bear between the two of us. So I had to find other ways to take care of myself. What I knew is I was in a toxic state of trauma, and I needed to become whole again, physically, mentally, spiritually, and emotionally. So what did I do? I talked to counselors. Counseling is not a sign of weakness. It's not a sign of frailty. It's a sign of taking seriously your need to be whole. So let me first of all, Claire, say that. If your society or your culture says counseling is for weaklings, I would refute that. We need counselors. We also need community and confidants. I went to my peers who I knew were in the same field and had experienced war and been involved in peace building work in different parts of the continent or the world. And I talked to them because I knew they could understand what I was going through. And then I committed to self-care. And what I mean by self-care is I started running. I'm a runner, jogger. I ran with my dog. I started eating a different diet. I played with my kids. I made sure I was doing things that were normal and whole and part of real life. I read and I prayed and I sang and I did music and dance, which is something I like to do, the arts. All of that became part of my commitment to taking care of myself. So I talk about these as the four C's. And the last one is I committed to my tradition of spiritual disciplines as a Christian. There are many, many resources around prayer and meditation and how to use the poetry of the Bible and all of that to help us heal. And so I began to explore prayer and meditation and fasting in deeper ways than I had ever before. And all of these four C's helped me to find resilience and well-being. I'm going to close this down now. I think I've gone on too long. Sorry about that. I read the scope of this particular conference that you're at on creative leadership, but this particular thing of holding the troubles and the need for listening and resilience and knowing ourselves and knowing the trauma and taking care of ourselves and all of that. And it was a beautiful set of values and principles driving this conference. And so I encourage you in that. I want to say three last words. This work is bigger than you. If we thought that this work was only about us, we would be a very small package. What I mean by that is when I go into conflict zones, I no longer think I'm bringing peace. I go with the assumption and the belief, and I've never been disappointed, that God or the spirit or the divine, whatever you want to call it, is at work there. And there are people doing hopeful things, good things, life-giving things. And my job is to find those people, those organizations, those communities, and align myself with them. And to try to do as little harm as possible. The second thing I would say is to young leaders, know your dark side. Don't believe you're invincible and don't believe that your good intentions are always the best. And don't believe that you are not capable of violence or darkness or dark actions or dark thoughts. The kind of very violence that you may be working against may be possible in your own heart. I had to come to the realization that I could have done the most heinous things had I grown up in a certain war zone, had I been kidnapped as a 7-year-old boy, lost my family and traumatized into war, maybe I would have been committing atrocities too. And when I came to the conclusion that my heart was capable of the same violence, then I was able to do my work with more grace and with more hope. Russian poet Alexander Solzhenitsyn says, the line between good and evil is drawn right down the middle of our hearts. And lastly, deep listening is a powerful tool, a very, very powerful tool. Sometimes listening is healing on its own. When you give people the dignity of listening to their story, hearing their pain, you are helping them in the road to healing. And I'll close with a quick story. We were involved in an intervention in 32 villages where there was conflict and violence in South Africa in the rural areas. And there was one village that all the other villages were blaming the violence on. They said, that village is where all the violence is happening. But that village, as is often the case, never came to any of our meetings, our conflict resolution processes. Months in, they arrived at one of our meetings, a delegation of them, and we were so surprised. We didn't even know they were coming. They came late, and we stopped our particular training or facilitated process, and we invited them to the front and let them tell their story. And they began to tell their story of trauma and pain, but they only told the story of their trauma and their pain. They took no responsibility for causing trauma and pain on others. And I remember thinking, as the facilitator, this is a disaster, because I watched the people who were listening becoming more and more restless and frustrated and angry because they were only hearing one side, a single story to the conflict. And this is what we're dangerous, if you know what I mean. But something in my spirit and my co-facilitator said, let's let them talk it out. And so they finally did. And when they were finally finished, we closed the meeting. I went back home and I told my colleague, Lucy, I said, that was a disaster. What I didn't know, we went back to Johannesburg days later. The leadership in the community called and said, we went to visit that community. And not only did they welcome us, but they gave us food, which is a sign that they are reconciling with us. And on top of that, they say they want to be part of the process. And they put forward five names of men, women, and children who would be trained as mediators. And we trained five people in every of the 32 villages. And they eventually stopped the political violence that was there. Now, I tell that story to say, by giving them the dignity of being heard, the system transformed, the conflict system transformed. Listening is very powerful. I'm going to stop now. I've talked too long, as I said, and I'm happy to take some questions. And I'm also, I told Jonas, I'm happy to stay for the tea time to talk some more if others would like to at that point. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Please, everyone, join me in thanking Dr. Caux for his amazing storytelling style. I hope everyone enjoyed the stories as much as I did. Now we get to move on to the questions and answers part. And as usual, there are two ways of doing this. You either raise your hand and we will call on you to ask your question, or you can use the chat section to also ask your question and we will read it out loud for you if you are unable to use a microphone maybe at the moment. Any first question?
I see a hand. Iman?
Iman? Yes, Iman, I guess.
Iman, okay.
Hello, Dr. Caux. It's the first time to meet you, and it's an honor. And I benefited a lot from your story. And thanks again for everything you shared with us. It's a pleasure.
Thank you.
My first question is how we can squeeze out from toxic stories, okay?
Yeah.
And my second and last question is how we can, if there are ways or tools to explore our dark side. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. Very, very insightful questions. I appreciate that. There are many ways to squeeze out the sponge, so to speak, to take care of self-care. I talked about the four C's for myself: spiritual, disciplined, you know, the self-care, physical, and my what I eat, my exercise, and then also the counselors and the confidants. So I think in the community, needing a community of support around you. I would hold to all four of those, not only when you are in crisis, but as part of your support, even when you're doing well, because this work is heavy work and you need all of those things. So I try to keep those. I didn't just do the spiritual disciplines to try to survive the trauma that I experienced from Sierra Leone. I do that on a daily basis. It's part of the way I nourish myself as I do this work, because I intend to be in this work for the long haul. But if I'm going to be in this work for the long haul, I have to pace myself carefully. Now, there may be many other ways to take care of yourself. And I would strongly encourage you to think about what is meaningful to you in your culture, in your cultural context, or your spiritual or religious context, if you have, you know, a specific religious or spiritual context that you're working from. What are the rituals, ceremonies? What we have discovered in trauma, that ritual and ceremony is very meaningful. It might be for you, it might be to go to a certain beautiful place of scenery or location where you feel peaceful. It might be for others to go to a place of worship and be engaged with a community around rituals that are meaningful. It might be listening to certain music, or it might be dancing. I love to dance. Dancing is a great way of releasing pent-up energy. That's why I think it's so important in so many cultures and religions. And there's an urban legend story of a women's conference, a global women's conference, and the women were talking about mild depression. And the Western women were saying, it's such a problem with us, and we have to take medications. Sometimes we don't, and the women from the Southern Hemisphere said, what is this thing called depression? Describe it to us. And the Western women said, oh, it's like, I can't get out of bed. I don't want to, you know, take care of the family. I don't want to go to work. I just am hopeless, whatever. And the African women said, oh, we know what that's about. So they said, but clearly you're not dancing around the fire enough. You're not releasing the tension. It could be anything in your culture that allows you to release that tension in a way. So that's on the release of the sponge. And sometimes it just means sleep. Sometimes it means going on a holiday. It's another thing. You young leaders, you know, you are doing really important work. And some of you think that maybe the work would not go forward without you. Well, let me tell you, after being in this field for three decades, the work will go on without you. You may be doing amazing work, but if you need to take a holiday, take a holiday. I've too frequently visited my colleagues in the hospital because they refuse to take a holiday until they collapse. Because they think, oh, how can I go to a holiday or go be peaceful if the people are still suffering from conflict? We need you alive and well and resilient to do the work. And if you work yourself till you collapse, then we've lost your gift in this work. The second question about tools for exploring the dark side. I don't know if there's specific tools. I would just challenge each of us to be aware of our own sense of pride or judgmentalism. You know, or the sense that I would never do that, or this person is acting subhuman. Yes, the atrocities that humans have done to each other and to children and to women and to men is sometimes too heavy for me to carry. I turn off the news. Sometimes I turn off the news. I can't watch the news all the time. And that's not because I'm hiding my head. It's because why should I have a diet 24/7 of trauma? I need something else too. And so I do that. I filter my news. I make sure I'm up to date with as much as possible, but I don't need to watch Hollywood violence to know violence is real. There was a movie that came out, I remember a Bruce Willis movie, and everyone said, you got to go see it because it's such, the violence is so realistic. Actually, it ended up being a really awful, in my mind, racist colonizing film. But anyway, that's another conversation on its own. Made me sick to my stomach to watch it in South Africa, where Bruce Willis saved Africa, et cetera. But I didn't need to go watch the violence in that movie because I heard the stories. I knew what this was about. I wasn't going to traumatize myself more. Now, the dark side, it's more just, as I said, it's a way of saying, I am a human being with foibles with weaknesses and with strengths. And I need to know how to use them at the service of this work of humanity. And that means sometimes I need to get my own heart and my own pride and my own judgmentalism out of the way. And when I came to the realization that I could be doing the atrocities of, you know, this particular militia group. I used to say Lord's Resistance Army in Uganda, if anyone knows about it, it's a particularly frustrating militia movement that claims to be listening to God and then committing the atrocities, that God tells them to cut people's arms and legs off and heads off. And so it's enough to do that. For me, it's so aggravating that they claim to be hearing from the Holy Spirit, that God, the Holy One, is telling them to do this. That makes me so angry. So I used to say I could never do work with the Lord's Resistance Army. It was like I said, God, don't call me to work with the Lord's Resistance Army. I won't be able to do that. Now, I never did work with them, but I believe once I understood my own heart, I would have been able to sit with them, even in the horrific work that they were doing.
There is a question in the chat section from Jiram, who asks, do we really recover from trauma, and how can we manage our trauma from crisis?
Yes. I do believe we can recover. Sometimes it takes a long journey. And sometimes if it's particularly severe and protracted and complex, it may take us a lifetime, and it may be more a sense of managing the trauma, but the trauma does not have to rule us. We do understand there are ways, physiological and emotional. It's not just only through talk therapy. There's also physiological ways to heal ourselves. And there's a lot of growing body of research to understand trauma. One of the problems that we have with trauma is that in order for resilience and trauma to take root, the trauma that's causing the hurt currently needs to be removed. In other words, if we try to do trauma healing with a group of a community that's going to go back into war, the same war that was causing the trauma to begin with, then in some ways we're doing them a disservice, because we're raising their hopes that they can be at peace and healed, and they're not going to be. And so that's why I work for peace and justice. I want to change the institutions causing the trauma too. But even in the midst of trauma, we can learn coping mechanisms, and we can teach coping mechanisms to people so that they can cope and limit the trauma a little bit more in the midst of it. But ultimately, we want to take people out of what's causing the trauma to begin with. And this is our challenge in peace building. I know there's been some activity on the chat that I haven't been able to keep track of, so I don't know if there's questions there. I also see Arpan has his hand up too.
Yes. Please go ahead, Arpan, if you can use a mic.
Sure. Well, thank you so much for this wonderful talk. There are two things that I was interested in learning a little more. One, it was not explicitly mentioned, but I thought I observed you doing that there is a internal parallel humor that is going within you. So there is like a parallel dialogue which you are also engaged in. And so I was hoping if you could speak a little bit more about the importance or significance of that, or if you have observed yourself doing that, or you. And the second thing was, when you were talking about the empty, you know, bullet shells or casings, empty casings. So that's a very semiotic thing, and symbols, you know, these symbols, sometimes they come uninvited in front of us and we don't even know, but they act as triggers. So in your experience and work, how have you worked with, like, sort of, you know, desensitizing individuals to these semiotic triggers, because, you know, they seem to abound and surround us in so many different ways. So one is the semiotic related aspect and the parallel, internal parallel humor. Just your thoughts.
Sure.
Happy to hear that.
Thank you, Arkan. As I said, you know, for me, humor is appropriate humor is a tool to help us to become more resilient. Sometimes if we don't laugh, we will only cry in despair. And so sometimes that's the only way for us to cope. And I don't mean that, again, at the expense of other people. And we have to be appropriate about our humor. Sometimes the humor that we may share as people in the same context of violence or conflict, it will not be understood by someone from the outside. And so I would not bring that humor to a group that's not in the same experience. We have to be in the same context to understand that kind of humor. And obviously then there's also cultural appropriate humor and so on and so forth. When I say humor, maybe I include laughter. I believe laughter is like tears. Tears help us to heal. Laughter is also a way to help us hear and heal. And there's research that indicates that if you laugh considerably over a meal, when you're eating a meal slowly and in good fellowship, and you laugh a lot, your digestion is better. You digest the food better when you laugh over a meal. So there's a place for this. And you know, obviously, most of our contexts have comedy or humor as part of our entertainment and so on in our leisure. And I think sometimes humor has a way of being able to tell us the truth in a package that we can receive, which otherwise we wouldn't. So, but you also talk about this sort of conversation or dialogue that I'm having in parallel. I think I would also say that for me, that is a spiritual dialogue. I'm going to be honest. That I believe that there is something bigger. There is a God, there is a divine spirit bigger than me, bigger than what we see, that there's a story behind the story. And that helps me to move forward in this work. For me, my faith is very important in this work. Some people say, well, with all of the horrific things that you've seen or experienced, how do you still believe there's a God? Well, that's a whole theological conversation that I'd be happy to have with anyone, which has to do with free choice and free will and God's intervention in our lives in particular ways. But regardless of that, and whether you believe in God or not, for me, that's been important because I've gone to some very desperate places. Some very hopeless places, dark places. And if I don't believe that there is anything bigger than myself and my colleagues and my organization or my training tools to offer, then I'm pitiful. It's a pitiful place to be. And some people feel that way, and that's why they stop doing this work, because it becomes an existential crisis to do this work. But if you believe that there is something bigger, someone, some being, some spirit bigger and more powerful at work in the most darkest and remotest places, then it becomes part of a new narrative that allows you to see with new gratitude and to see joy and to see God in other human beings. But that's another story, maybe on its own. And you talked about the symbols, very important, both for healing, trauma healing, we need the symbols of meaning. That's what I meant by ritual and ceremony. But also, you're right, symbols can be triggering. And one of the ways in which we care for ourselves, some of you were asking about that, is to know what triggers us. So if you know what has caused the hurt and harm, you've identified that, you've been processing that in your past, you're not carrying it as an unfinished business, then it's important that you name the triggers that could trigger you, the things that may trigger you. And then you can't always avoid them, but you can if you have some ways of advancing yourself or advancing your planning or whatever in the process. But even if you can't avoid them, by naming them and saying, this is a trigger for me and I'll need, and I know I can process it, you know, having a plan for how you're going to process it if you get triggered by it becomes really important. But sometimes as facilitators, as leaders, we may need to excuse ourselves, recuse ourselves from certain roles or functions that we know may trigger us. You know, if there's a survivor of rape, I'm not going to easily or quickly encourage that person to come in between as a mediator between those who've caused sexual violence in war. I'm going to say, unless you feel you're really strong in a place of healing, this may be a very difficult role that you're placing yourself in. Mm-hmm. Jocelyn.
Bonjour, thank you so much, Jimmy Bush, Dr. Carl. I really appreciated your story. And the reason I smiled or laughed, or I think I could relate to a lot of things you share with working with our Indigenous people here. They often say the type of trauma that they have, post-traumatic trauma, is very similar to like someone who's been in the war.
Mm-hmm.
And the doctors, the specialists will say it's 10 times more than the ones that come out of Vietnam War. So I appreciate also the fact that you brought forward about laughter, and that's one of our ways as Indigenous people, is to laugh a lot. They say Creator has given us five gifts that are given to us that we should use. And laughter is one of them. Tears is the other one. Sighing, you know, like, to let go. Talking, and often our body will shake, eh?
Yes.
But the reason I want to ask you a question on doing this kind of work, you get to know internationally who's going to be leading into different groups. And I wonder if the International Council has a specific course that prepares these people ahead of time to understand that part and how to take care of themselves. And what I'm saying is that because I have a counseling degree too, where we've taken some of that self-care courses, plus our Indigenous way of doing things also through ceremonies and letting go and smudging. So we learn through our elders, but I'm kind of wondering, like, you know, people are coming from all over doing work within their own countries, but they are on the international scene or coming in to be trained by you guys. Do you have a specific course? I think you'd be a great person to do that kind of work if that's ever something that hasn't been put on the platform.
Sure. Thank you for that. I think the short answer is we don't have enough. No. So a lot of times our training, I'm not talking specifically about just USIP or any organization in particular. I'm talking about in the Western Hemisphere, particularly our training is very westernized. It's very rationalized and psychological in a sort of a scientific way that is not often helpful or flexible for particular contexts all around the world. And I wish we had more sensitive training across the board. We are increasing that. But I think what we need to train in is not so much specifics of a particular country or a region or a culture, but we need to train people to be sensitive to the context and to realize that they are not the next in any context except their own. And therefore, they need to go into another, if we're going to go into another context, we should get a team of local persons who are our eyes and our ears and our mouthpiece for the local people. And we should allow them to guide what we do and how we respond. Because as you said, rightly said, there are so many ways of handling trauma. This is not a new thing. Trauma is a psychological word that the West came up with, but trauma is a universal experience that's been happening long before we ever came up with that word.
Right. I think I was talking more for the facilitators like yourself. You often spoke about how many drop out. They're burnt out.
Yeah.
And you've learned that, okay, I need to take time away, but I'm coming back. But a lot of them don't come back because they've gone too far. Those are the people I'm talking about.
Yeah. Yeah.
Those are the people I'd like to see courses for.
No, I think that's really important. It's very important. The university that I trained, taught at for 10 years before taking this work on at USIP, we brought trauma healing and the trauma research into the degree. It was a master's degree in peace and conflict transformation. And we brought the trauma in, and many universities looked funny at us. They said, no, the trauma goes with psychology or, you know, whatever. And we said, no, if we don't understand trauma, how can we do peace building? And that meant trauma for ourselves and how to take care of ourselves so that we can do this work with care. Mm-hmm. And so I think your suggestion your observation and suggestion is very important. And I wish we could continue to increase its that potential in the training. Unfortunately, I still feel like too many of us have a neo-colonial way in which we approach the work, and we come to save or to be the messiah or to change people. And that's not our job. If we are to be conduits. Catalysts,
yeah,
you know, and we are to walk with and accompany those who are in their own context experts to what they've experienced, and understanding that becomes a journey that many people have to take, and sometimes it takes a long time, but training would help.
For sure. Good.
Thank you so much, Dr. Caux, for these thorough answers. And for everyone who still has questions, it is unfortunately time to wrap up this session, but we still have Dr. Caux for the tea time. So he's going to be in one of the rooms, and there you can ask all of your questions. Now I will get to hand it over to Sidra, I guess, for the tea time. Thank you.
Hello, I would like to second Cinda and come in and thank you, Dr. Caux, so much for this amazing session. Honestly, for me as well, on a personal level, I benefited so much.